It was C.S. Lewis who said that the two things that the devil abominates are music and silence. How poor our lives would be without music. And think how much poorer our part of the world, our Scotland, Britain, Europe, would be without churches, how different the skylines of our cities would be. Now, some churches indeed are in ruins. Some have been transformed, for example, in this city, across the road into Seoul or Babylon or Redemption. Some are neglected or shabby, some are drab or cold, some are unsuccessful experiments. But on the whole, they are an asset. They are among the most architecturally accomplished and long-standing of all our public buildings, the most evocative and atmospheric. They can be breathtakingly beautiful, curious, intriguing, and rich in symbolism, art, and history. In them, we find space shaped to a noble purpose. We hear music and singing. We see painting, sculpture, glass. Here are the elements of the natural world reshaped by human craft. Here are representations of the Bible and the Gospels, the stories of God's dealing with humankind. Churches gather reality together. They are simultaneously public and private. They are often the most frequented of our buildings, the most open and accessible. They are places where that most peculiar and precious of all human activities can take wing. I mean prayer. My house will be a house of prayer for all nations. Here, the Christian community in a given place is gathered together by the unseen action of the Holy Spirit to listen to God's word, to pray as one, to receive and celebrate the sacraments, and above all, the Eucharist. They are pointers, our churches, to the heavenly temple. They. One could go on and on. They are, of course, in the scale of values, second-order things. Christianity can do without them, and often, under pressure of persecution or poverty, has to. But still, our world would be poorer without them, culturally, sensorily, spiritually, and as Christians, we would feel deprived, unanchored, unsheltered. Cathedrals are often hard work, high maintenance, we might say, but they are designed and built to the glory of God, entrusted to Him and His saints. They are holy places. They are dedicated by a special liturgy, and we are glad they exist. We keep their anniversaries. They are good things. And tonight we have lit the candles above the consecration crosses round the church in memory of what happened. And among churches, cathedrals are, let's say, the aristocrats. They are the mother churches of their diocese. They are a strong center of liturgical life. They are where the bishop has his cathedra, his seat, the sign of his authority as teacher and shepherd. The cathedral, said Blessed Paul VI, should be regarded as the image of Christ's visible church, praying, singing, and worshiping on earth. It should be regarded as the image of Christ's mystical body, whose members are joined together in an organism of charity, sustained by the outpouring of God's gifts. And so today we keep the anniversary of this Cathedral of St. Mary, the anniversary of its dedication, a solemnity here and a feast through the rest of the diocese. It is wonderful to have our liturgy enhanced by the Con Anima Chamber Choir and the music, among others, of Hans Leo Hassler. And it's good to have this cathedral. Now, one can always improve a cathedral. One could always better it and enhance it. But here it is, dedicated first in 1860, and then, after reordering, rededicated in 1960. It's noble and spacious as a building, and the flowing pillars of the nave, the architects will tell you, were extraordinary for their time, the late 1850s. It's a cathedral with all the essentials and more: space and light, a font, an altar, an ambo, a tabernacle, a confessional, the chapel of Our Lady of Aberdeen, an organ. It has the Stations of the Cross and a rosary window. It stands in the very center of the city, and all sorts of conditions of men and women are found in and around it. You could compose a litany of all those who have contributed to its fabric and life, beginning with the architect and masons, listing the administrators and bishops, recalling those buried here, the artists whose works adorn it, the sacristans, the altar servers, those whose prayers over almost 160 years have passed into the stone and the walls. Many saints are commemorated here in differing ways. Mary, the Mother of God, above all. And high up at the west end, the back there, from this point of view, is the little window of the dove, a sign of the Holy Spirit who hovers over our being here. And high at the east end, opened up, as it were, by the cross, behind me here, is the large round rose window, a symbol of eternity, of our heavenly goal. But above all, thanks be to God, this cathedral is alive. More and more, thanks to Eucharist adoration, this cathedral is becoming a place of prayer. Friendships and connections are formed. Nationalities are transcended. All grow into one holy temple of God. A missionary attitude is being formed. The Father is worshipped in spirit and in truth. So, tonight, our hearts lifted by musical beauty, we give thanks for this church. It is a sign that the Lord is with us and that we can be with him.